Well, good afternoon, everyone, and welcome to this panel on Russia nuking space, looking at possible motivations and implications of the Russian nuclear anti-satellite weapon that we've been hearing about this spring. Thank you all for attending. To those of you out there on Zoom, thank you for joining us today. Those of you in the future watching us on YouTube, thank you for your interest. I think we've got a great panel today. Let me do a couple of quick introductions and then tell you about our lineup. There'll be four of us speaking today. I'm David Burbach. I teach in the National Security Affairs Department here at the Naval War College, political scientist focused on space security. I'll be starting off with an overview of what is this news? Why does it matter? What military strategic reasons might Russia see for going to nuclear anti-satellite weapons in space? And some possible responses for the U.S. We'll then move on to, actually, let me let you give yourself a quick introduction, Derrill.
I'm Derrill Goldizen. I work in the College of Distance Education, professor in the Joint Military Operations Department there. And I had a period of about 10 years where I worked in the space business back in the last century.
Excellent. And Professor Goldizen will be telling us who is has a space physics background, will be telling us more about what nuclear weapons actually do in space, what effects they'll have on satellites. If I can go to Zoom, Major Ormsby, could you introduce yourself?
Thank you very much, sir. Good to be with everyone today virtually. Major Matt Ormsby, I'm an assistant professor of law at the U.S. Air Force Academy. I've been here for a year. Teach a course on space law, as well as our core course that every cadet has to take, covering constitutional law issues and law of war. So very honored to be here with everyone today.
Great. We're very glad that you can join us. And Matt will speak to what international law has to say about nuclear weapons in space. And then rounding it out, my colleague, Nick Bostev.
So I'm Dave's colleague in the National Security Affairs Department, and I'll try to get inside the mental maps and thinking of the leadership in the Kremlin on this, how it fits into overall Russian grand strategy.
Excellent. Thank you very much. And so we look forward to your questions. And frankly, I look forward to ideas, too, because there is still quite a bit about this that is mysterious and hard to explain. So if any of you have any good ideas to fill in some of the gaps on what exactly Putin and the Russian government might be up to, we would love to hear them. But to start us off, what we learned back in February, there was a somewhat stunning news that came out that the U.S. intel community has evidence that Russia was considering placing nuclear weapons in orbit to potentially detonate them as an anti-satellite weapon. This was really shocking. Nobody really expected this, partly because, as Major Ormsby will fill in, it's illegal. Not that countries don't do illegal things, but we've seen the, typically thought of the Outer Space Treaty from the 1960s as a pretty foundational arms control treaty that we agreed to pretty easily back then because nobody seemed very interested in placing nuclear weapons in orbit. So this was pretty surprising news, and it's been fleshed out a little bit. Just in the last 2 weeks, the administration has had officials from both state and DOD, as well as National Security Advisor Sullivan, go into some more detail and made clear this really is about putting nuclear bombs in orbit where they would be used for anti-satellite purposes. Evidence is apparently that the Russians have even done some tests, not nuclear tests in space, but they have had some satellites that in some way have been doing testing of components or operational concepts, that they really do seem to be working on this and seemed, in fact, to potentially be putting the actual nukes in space in the relatively near future, more like, the next year or two, not a 10 or 20 year, very long-term hypothetical program. As we'll hear about from Professor Goldizen, this would be a real threat to U.S. satellites, to everybody's satellites. They'd be able to take out a massive number of satellites all at once, create persistent danger for satellites and astronauts. And because it's so illegal and so indiscriminate, it just seems a very surprising thing for Russia to do. So I'd like to just think a little more about what some of the strategic motivations might be. To do that, let me back up first and just say a little bit about how we've typically understood space security, military space, where the classical paradigm Everybody had a small number of really expensive satellites. You know, GPS relies on about 30. We had fewer than 10 missile warning satellites in geosynchronous orbit. Relatively small number of very large, very expensive communication satellites. And individually, satellites are pretty vulnerable to be shot down. Their orbits are very predictable. They can't maneuver easily and rapidly. You can't really armor a satellite the way that you would a tank because they would be way too heavy to launch. You know, maybe Elon Musk will change that, but traditionally they've been very fragile, and very expensive. So the thinking is if you really wanted to take out somebody's satellites, a relatively small arsenal of conventional kinetic, conventional explosive or just straight hit to kill, conventional anti-satellite missiles would really let you do some pretty serious damage to somebody's military capabilities. In the US, we tested such a weapon, launched off an F-15 back in the 1980s. Some F-15 pilot in the 80s has a little symbol of a satellite painted on the side of his plane. We decided it wasn't worth deploying weapons like that. The Russians have, you can see in my slide there, they have something called the Nudal, which can shoot down satellites. They did a test in 2021 that created significant debris. Probably, I've seen estimates that they may have, more than 10, less than 100 of them. But also both sides kind of hope that since we had a mutual dependence upon space for nuclear warning, nuclear command and control, maybe we kind of leave each other alone. People talked about it sometimes as a sanctuary paradigm. Well, things have been changing a little bit lately, and the big change, if any of you are familiar with Elon Musk, SpaceX's Starlink system, where they now have almost 6,000 satellites in low Earth orbit, providing internet service from space. And there are other examples. Planet Labs, you probably see their images on the news. They have several hundred imaging satellites in low Earth orbit, imaging every spot on Earth a couple of times a day. There are other companies also building these mega constellations for communications, for imaging, constellations of synthetic aperture radar satellites are now, by the way, side note, if any of you don't understand that you are being constantly watched from space in a hyperspectral sense from multiple different companies, you are, hiding doesn't happen anymore. They are watching you wherever you are. And this is really good for our military. We know how to use data like this. We're getting better at distributing communications, at being able to incorporate this sort of multi-phenomenology ISR. And you can see in Ukraine, where Ukraine has been able to make some use of technology like this, either from military satellites, and we are looking to move towards proliferating more of our own satellites in low orbit. And Russia saw this very much working to Ukraine's advantage with Ukraine's ability to use the Starlink system. So this presents a real dilemma for an adversary like Russia, because you can't shoot down 6,000 satellites in low Earth orbit, or at least you'd have to buy a lot of expensive big anti-satellite missiles. And even if you do, again, the SpaceX is the extreme example, they're launching 50 of them every week. So if you expend your entire current arsenal of anti-satellite missiles, shoot down 50 Starlink satellites, next week SpaceX has replaced them. It's also hard to do when they're in low Earth orbit. The signal strength on the ground is much higher than from geosynchronous orbit. You've got lots of satellites to jam at once. They're moving fast. It's a much harder jamming problem, too. And while cyber might work, in fact, the Russians did take out a different satellite system called Viasat at the beginning of the war. So far, they've apparently failed to take out Starlink. So maybe you have a vulnerability, maybe not. You can't necessarily count on that. So what is a sure thing? Well, nuclear weapons turn out to be extremely effective as anti-satellite weapons. And we'll hear more about that from Derrill. But even a relatively low-yield warhead in orbit can cause tremendous damage to any satellite that's line of sight at the time of explosion. And even beyond that, creates long-lasting, persistent radiation belts that will degrade the electronics in satellites. It'll also degrade astronauts pretty badly and will last for potentially months. In a congressional hearing 2 weeks ago, Assistant Secretary of Defense for Space John Plum agreed when a member asked, so like this could make low orbit unusable for a whole year for everyone. And, you know, Plum assented that that was probably a plausible ballpark. And this would affect everybody's satellites, our satellites, Russian satellites, Chinese satellites, everybody's satellites. So this would be pretty serious. You know, it potentially from just, you know, one, two small number of nuclear explosions, you could render the Starlink constellation inoperative. You would affect those low-level ISR satellites from Planet Labs, Maxar, Capella. Impacts at higher altitudes like GPS or communication satellites, geosynchronous orbit would still probably have some effects. You know, maybe you can speak a bit to you know, what the effect would be farther out. One thing that also would be, you know, a very long-lasting effect with those 6,000 Starlink satellites, if you knock them out, they are all now hazards to navigation. They're no longer able to deorbit themselves at the end of their lives. They can no longer do collision avoidance maneuvers. So even when the radiation has died away, you now have a vastly more severe orbital debris problem than before this nuke went off. And again, it probably would mean abandoning the International Space Station forever. The space station is not designed to operate autonomously. It needs astronauts on board to tend it. And you really couldn't keep astronauts up there with the radiation levels this would create. So this would be a big deal. Now, typically, we thought, well, but there are some big downsides, like not least you take out all your own stuff with this, too. It would affect Russian cosmonauts as much as astronauts. It would take out Russian satellites. It would take out Chinese and Indian satellites. And the Chinese are also building some of these low Earth orbit mega constellations. They have their own space station that they're very proud of that cost a lot of money for them to build. They have their own military uses of low Earth orbit. India, which gets along pretty well with Russia, also has big ambitions in space and would be affected by this. It would certainly violate the Outer Space Treaty. It would violate the limited nuclear test ban treaty, and would just be a big diplomatic show. I mean, even putting the weapon without detonating it would be a huge violation of norms. And even China's indicated they really don't like the idea of violating the Outer Space Treaty with this. One of the things that kind of really makes people wonder, just at a practical military level, putting the nuclear weapon in orbit before you need it, we and the Russians have typically not left nuclear weapons laying unattended somewhere. You know, we've wanted to keep them in a hole in the ground in Wyoming, in a ballistic missile submarine, on an airbase with lots of armed guards keeping an eye on them. If you put the weapon in orbit, if it malfunctions, oh well, you know, you can't fix it. If it's in orbit, you know, if you, what's the James Bond movie with the volcano lair and the, they send the spaceship.
You only live twice.
Like the James Bond movie, You Only Live Twice, we could send something up, grab it and steal it and bring it back to Earth. Now, they would see us coming and that would be kind of an exciting day to play out. But typically, no more than we let nuclear weapons float freely in the ocean, potentially use them someday. So, and in fact, there are some DC analysts who find this so inconceivable, they still figure we must be misunderstanding the intel somehow, that it just seems so crazy to put it in orbit ahead of time. And maybe Nick can speak to, maybe Putin wants to send a signal. And in fact, I guess to not to steal Nick's thunder, but you know, why would they do this? And one answer might be, it's just they find the U.S. advantage, you know, how we can our force enhancement from space may just be so severe that they want to hedge and be able to say, we're going to take all of that capability away from you. Beyond that, it may be something like the madman theory, where, you know, you signal to the other side that you're irrational. If you get angry enough, you'd be willing to make dumb but terrible decisions. And, you know, this would kind of salt the Earth, or salt Earth orbit, I guess, more precisely. And maybe the Russians want to send that signal that we just don't care. If we're that cornered, if we're that angry, we're willing to impose costs on everyone. Most of you will have been through the foreign policy analysis part of TSDM or NSDM. And, you know, we always say, it may not be the strategic arguments at all. You want to think about leader personalities, about bureaucratic interests. Maybe this is, you know, a weapons lab run amok, given the wartime conditions. But one point that I think is important is the, well, they wouldn't do it because it would hurt their own satellites. It is important to realize Russia is very much a declining space power. Even before the Ukraine war, they were really, on the downslope. They were just not a significant player in the commercial space markets for communications or ISR. Even for launch, SpaceX was starting to eat their lunch, and now nobody will deal with them because of the Ukraine sanctions. Even on the military side, Russia just doesn't have that many ISR satellites. They don't have that many communication satellites. You know, their blown-ass navigational system, they're able to keep it up, but are struggling just to do that. So unlike China, which, side note on space, China's throwing up new ISR satellites at a tremendous rate. You know, whatever your sense of what China's capabilities were, if you're thinking more than 3 or 4 years ago, it's worth looking at more recent reports, because they're putting up dozens of military ISR satellites a year. Russia just isn't. So Russia may figure, if we totally abandon space, that doesn't take much away from Russian national interests. Though, again, I could imagine them getting an angry phone call from Beijing the day after they set that off. So last thing that I'll say, what do we do about it? Well, what we are doing already is diplomacy, where before this leak, I gather, we've indicated we were quietly telling the Russians, we know what you're up to. It's a bad idea. You should stop. Now that it's public, we have been trying to name and shame them. We tried to get a UN Security Council resolution that would reaffirm the Outer Space Treaty limits. Russia vetoed it. China abstained, not vetoed, and did issue a statement we don't want to single out any countries, but yeah, we do certainly agree that nobody should put a nuclear weapon in space. We could do more to defend our satellites passively by hardening them against radiation. Now, you can't do that to satellites that are already up there. There's a trade-off in mass. The good news is it's getting cheaper to throw up heavier satellites. And DOD has actually, I've seen some statements from DOD leaders even before this broke, encouraging the commercial sector to think more about radiation hardening, precisely against the possibility there could be a nuclear weapon in space someday. Deterrence is the usual go-to. If you do this, we will do something terrible in return. Active defense is kind of interesting, where, like I said, you might be able to locate and sabotage or isolate or, know what these satellites are up to. The last point there's a think tank report from a pretty, aggressively leaning think tank, the Mormon Center from the National Security Space Association. They recommend that we have a presidential finding authorizing covert action inside Russia to sabotage the construction of these nuclear weapons or sabotage the launches of these weapons. We did Stuxnet in Iran. That was successful. Whether we're able to do that to Russian nuclear weapon manufacturing facilities, it's certainly an exciting possibility to consider how that goes. But, it shows what a big deal this is, that you're even seeing that suggestion out there at all. So I've run a little long, but that gives you the big picture on this. Let me now hand it over to Derrill to start talking about what do these nukes actually do in space?
Do we have any space operations officers in here? Oh, good. Nuclear physicists. I'm not an expert in nuclear physics or the effects of nuclear warheads, but I'm going to tell you what I know about it. So, probably need to. Can you see over there if I point up here? Okay. Let's see. Oh, I didn't want to do that. Okay, we don't have time. Okay, so when I got involved in this business back in the last century, the models that we had were static. They were specification models, meaning you could tell what they look like right now. Now, today we have dynamic models. Here's one of the magnetosphere, solar winds on the left. It just shows you the interaction of a coronal mass ejection with Earth's magnetosphere. We got more creative with graphics, color, resolution, things like that. This is based on data. And we have a lot more sensors, so we can get real-time updates on things like the South Atlantic anomaly. You can look at online, you can see how this changes every year now. So what happens when you have a nuclear blast? You get radiation, right? You get particulate radiation, alpha particles, which are helium. Of course, neutrons, beta particles are electrons and positrons, but for our purposes, we'll just think electrons. And then, of course, gamma rays. From most ionizing to least, neutrons are very ionizing, obviously. Penetration potential, though, alpha particles don't go very far. Stop by a piece of paper, beta particles by a few millimeters of aluminum, gamma radiation, this is actual electromagnetic radiation, the shortest wavelengths in the spectrum can go through concrete. So, and the thing about this radiation, all of these things, if it weren't for the presence of a magnetic field, all of them would be able to affect satellites. They would just come straight at you. Beta particles, electrons and positrons, are influenced by Earth's geomagnetic field. They tend to cycle around them. They follow helical trajectories along Earth's geomagnetic field lines. It's because of the Lorentz force, the magnetic component of the Lorentz force. That's the most math I guess I can talk about, right?
Okay. There are some backup slides with equations if you want.
Yeah, he told me I couldn't show anything like that. So all of these things can ionize atoms and molecules. All satellites within line of sight will be affected. So think about that. All satellites within line of sight of the blast. Constellations, though, not so much, because the Earth blocks most of the satellites in a constellation that are spread all around the globe, right? At most, 10 to 15% of a constellation could be affected, but not more than that. I don't think I've lied about anything so far. Okay, this is going to be complicated. What does the pulse look like for an electro or for an EMP? Or a high altitude EMP. This is the waveform. It's not well known because this is based on experiments that were done from 1958 to 1962, actual in situ explosions. In the US case, it was over the Pacific, and in the Russians' case, it was over parts of their own country. Let's focus on, well, first let me explain the graph. You have time down here, so we go from less than a nanosecond up to several minutes. And then this is the electric field potential, volts per meter, from less than a millivolt to up to almost 100,000 volts per meter. Now, that's 100 kilovolts per meter. What's, anybody know the atmospheric or air's breakdown voltage? It's about half that. So you can imagine what would happen to a satellite when that electromagnetic field impinges upon it. So this first millisecond, let's say, this is called the early time part of the spectrum. What happens here is that the gamma rays that actually go down toward the atmosphere super ionize it, and it creates creates currents that create magnetic fields. But it's a very short, intense current, very short, intense magnetic field. And what that says is you generate an electric field, which then propagates away, and that's that 50 volts per meter. Even if you take that and 1 over r squared out to where the satellites are, it's still very strong. Okay, enough said. So for example, you get damage like this. This is a solar array. It has some arcing go on. Solid state devices like CMOS, what are their operating voltages? Less than 5 volts, right? So if the wires that feed a CMOS, for example, even if their wires are very short, when you've got 50 kilovolts per meter, you can easily generate a voltage that exceeds the breakdown voltage of these devices. So you'll get these, or you'll get the currents that will melt them, or the breakdown voltage will just fry them. So this is really what kills computers and communication circuits. And all this happens in less than a millisecond for satellites that were within line of sight. So think about that. Okay. Now I'm going to talk about, I'm going to skip the E2 phase. If something happens there, but it's not going to really be a problem for satellites, as far as I'm aware. But now we're looking at the time period from about a second to several minutes. This is called the late time phase. Here you'll notice that the electric field potential is down around the millivolt per meter range, not that strong. This is really important for things that happen on the ground, okay? This is a magnetohydrodynamic signal. It has to do with, well, we'll get to it.
So even though this is only in the millivolt range, it does persist for like 100 seconds or so. So if you have a long enough conductor that could pick up that weak signal over a meter, but if it's thousands of meters long, let's say, like a power line or a pipeline, you could generate enough voltage. Anything connected to it, so what's going to happen? You're going to get a current surge. It could melt whatever the device is, cause some sort of damage. So, for example, here you have a capacitor that burnt out. This is from that Hydro-Quebec transformer failure back in the 80s, where one third of the country's grid went down. A whole bunch of transformers are burnt out. Those are the windings of one of the transformers. This one, well, that's all I'm going to say about it.
That was from a solar geomagnetic storm, right?
Yeah, that was geomagnetic. No, we hadn't blown off a nuke. But, yeah, okay. So let's turn to, did you mention swordfish?
I don't think you did. I had it in the slides.
There was a photo. I didn't say much about it.
So we're going to turn to this experiment. It was one of 11 that extra atmospheric tests that the United States did from 58 to 62. It was considered the most successful, the most well-documented, and even as late as 2006, we were still analyzing some of the data from that. So that's 44 years later. I don't know if you read this. They're talking here about the diamagnetic cavity created by the explosion itself, the plasma plume. So let me explain the perspective here. So you're looking east, north is to your right, south is to your left. Here's Johnson Island. That's where the device was launched from. And at 400 kilometers, it was detonated. It was 1.4 megaton blast, one of the largest. And within 1.2 seconds, it had created a plasma bubble that extended 1,800 kilometers along the magnetic field lines. And I think the depth here is about 600 in 1.2 seconds. Okay, so what's going on in that plasma bubble? Anyone want to venture a guess? Highly conducting, superconducting fluid, high temperature plasma. What do low temperature semiconductors do? The magnetic fields. The Admiral probably knows. Okay, so this is my poor attempt to show you what's going on, but superconductors
push out
magnetic fields. And there's, I can't use Maxwell's equations. Okay. But so what's happening below plasma bubble? The field's getting stronger. So you might imagine you can detect it at the surface. I'm going to show you that. Let's see. Yeah, I'm not going to talk about Maxwell's equations. Okay, so here's the effect that you measure at the surface. So the perspective, well, this is time from more than a millisecond to minutes. And this is Earth's geomagnetic field. Normally at that latitude, it's about 0.343 Gauss. This just shows you the excursion from that occurred because of the blast. From time T0 all the way up to about, 300 seconds, so about 5 minutes. If you look at geomagnetic storms and the geomagnetic trace you get from surface magnetometers, it looks a lot like this. So this is a magnetohydrodynamic wave that very much mimics a geomagnetic storm. And so you have these little blips here. This is the original compression of the magnetic field underneath the plasma bubble, increases the field there. And then you get this thing called, this is called initiation. Then you get, that's sudden commencement. Then you get initiation. And then you get this long dip, which is called the main phase, which an actual geomagnetic storm could last for a long time. This one didn't because the plasma bubble collapsed. But that expansion and collapse causes a lot of things like that.
Derrill, can I ask a quick
synthetic
question here? So graph looks like a huge deviation and may well be in particle physics and all that, but the numbers are quite small.
Yes,
they are. Is that a bad thing? Is that a big bad thing when we see that drop down?
Yeah, because this is also related to those ground-induced currents or geomagnetically induced currents that you get in pipelines and stuff like that. And so that doesn't often happen, but that's what happened that caused the Hydro-Quebec failure.
This caused some blackouts on Hawaii, right?
Oh, yeah. I could play that video. Do I have time?
He doesn't want to talk about Maxwell's equations, but changes in the magnetic field are a problem. So steep lines up and down, that's the bad part. And that's a steep line.
Yeah, yeah. That's Maxwell's equation.
Knocked out a bunch of power on Hawaii when it happened.
dBdt equals E. So if you get a change of magnetic field over time, you're going to get it. It's going to generate an electric field. And that's what happens there. But it was the cause of the Hydro-Quebec failure.
Can I ask a quick question around this? So, why is it called a magnetohydrodynamic? Where does the hydro come from?
It's a fluid. It's a fluid. Plasma's a fluid.
Okay, gotcha.
So it's, yeah.
Well, we're
any nuclear engineers in here? They know what I'm talking about.
So
subs, yes, sir.
Just out of curiosity, I just wrote a paper about coordinated universal time and understanding why the 60 Hertz oscillations were coming from that power station. I assume that this would also affect the frequency of those oscillations. Meaning
for the power station?
Correct.
That's it. I would think so. These oscillations here are actually the power station on Johnston Island.
Right, but given the time that this was conducted, those oscillations were very specifically to keep clocks in unison over a power grid. So if you were worried about keeping universal time, or UTC as we call it now, it affects a lot of stuff.
Yeah.
We've talked about a lot of stuff, but it also has the potential to affect the mean average of universal time over a given period, I assume.
Yeah, I would imagine. Just like, you know what ionospheric scintillation is? Mm-hmm. That's one of the effects.
Right.
Of this, but yeah, it could throw off your precision, navigation, and timing, your clock basically, and everything that goes with that. I'll throw something up here about that. Well, if I have time, I'll get to the little 1 minute video that talks about starfish. Here's the important thing though. All these effects I've talked about so far aren't the important ones. Long-term, okay? So this is the same perspective before, looking east, north, south. And these are the magnetic field lines. And this is a representation of the electron flux at different altitudes. And you'll notice that the density gradient is perpendicular to the magnetic field lines. Basically, because of that gyration motion I was talking about, the fact that they bounce back and forth between mirror points, between here and the conjugate point in the other hemisphere, they become trapped or confined to these things called flux tubes. And here's the neat thing though, the higher the latitude you go, the higher a particular flux tube crosses the geomagnetic equator. So, but it won't get any higher than that. So if you wanna reach high altitude satellites, you have to set this thing off at high latitudes. If you set it off at the equator, it's gonna go almost nowhere. So, I mean, it's just gonna bounce around about 600 kilometers. But what's important about this, if you look at this, and I'm going to say this is 300 all the way up to about 1600, but most of this is all in the low Earth orbit regime. So any satellite whose perigee or part of their perigee comes into that regime is going to be affected. How many satellites do we have with perigee, lowest point in their orbit at under 1,000 kilometers? Lots, most of them, right? But what about geostationary? Well, to get to a geostationary satellite, you'd have to launch at a very high latitude or explode at a very high latitude. And here's the thing. As you go out, those flux tubes get bigger and bigger, more volume. And so you really can't explode a big enough bomb to fill that up enough so that you get a flux that's that dangerous to a geostationary satellite. The way you kill a geostationary satellite is you go up there and explode whatever next to it. That would work. In fact, yeah, but you're not going to get these fluxes that feed into the ring current system, become part of the Van Allen radiation belts. And these things persist for months. So here, this is 4 months after Starfish, and there's still this artificial inner radiation belt. Still very strong. This is about 600 kilometers right there. So this is still, this is still low Earth orbit. And that's why, because at the time we had 24 satellites, we being the Americans, being the human race, we had 24 satellites around the Earth. And eight of them, or nine of them, failed eventually, or were damaged so that they had to be shut down. And if you just look at the dates here, so Starfish Prime was 9 July 1962. So, yeah, this is when they either failed or were turned off. 12 August 62, Telstar, the very first communication satellite, failed in 21 Feb 63, a few months later. So if you look days to months later, that's because those belts are still there. And every time that satellite came within the belt, or might've been in it all the time, it was going to be exposed to this radiation. And so you get these sorts of effects. And I'm not going to talk about these, except to say that all of these persist with the exception of ionospheric scintillation. That'll go away fairly quickly. But the rest of these are dependent upon the plasma environment that up in those artificial radiation belts. And that persists for months. And then, of course, you said something about space junk.
Okay.
So you're probably going to get micrometeoroids from all of this destruction. And worst case is, as pieces come off of a satellite or you lose the ability to command and control it, if it doesn't come straight in and burn up, you could get a cascade effect. You could have lots of satellites in a particular orbital regime. All of a sudden, it's a cascade, right? What am I trying to say here?
Chain reaction.
Yeah, chain reaction. There you go. Chain reaction. And then you'll have a particular regime that you just can't use because it's unsafe. Like you mentioned, ISS. Yeah, you don't want to be up there. That's really the end of the brief, unless you have any other questions, but we can wait till the Q&A, I guess.
Yeah, let me thank you very much. Let's move on to legal implications. And what does international law say about this? Major Hornsby.
All right, thank you. Good afternoon, everyone. Thanks for the opportunity to speak with you today. Dr. Burbach, especially, sir, thanks for coordinating this event and inviting me to speak today. So thank you all. We'll do a quick U-turn here. I know from Dr. Goldizen that he does probably advanced math in his sleep, and that will transition to the lawyer, who's basically math incompetent. Maybe some of you can sympathize with me. I didn't apply to the Air Force Academy back in the day, and that's probably a good thing considering all the core courses that they have to take. It's very engineering and math intensive. As we've been saying today, there's a lot that we don't know about this possible weapon. And at least from the public releases and the news that we see every day, still somewhat unclear what sort of weapon this is, how far it's progressed, what exactly Russia has done. And for lawyers especially, I'll say that makes it really hard to apply the law if the facts are still somewhat murky. So people ask us for legal advice every day, and lawyers, as you know, love to say it depends. And that's especially true, I think, in the present case, where the facts are still evolving and we still need to know a lot about it so we can make a good determination. But the question here is, we've had anti-satellite weapons for many years, for decades. But if intelligence is accurate, could Putin legally launch a nuclear weapon, an anti-satellite weapon, into orbit? So what I'll do is I'll break down what space law says. And then through that lens, we can talk about potential paths forward. So not to insult anyone's intelligence, I'll start from the fundamentals here, since some of you may not have a background in space law or in international law as it applies to outer space. And the starting point is that space law is international law. So our key sources of space law are traditional treaties, customary international law, and then general principles of law. This is all restated in Article 38 of the ICJ statute, which is more or less viewed as kind of where international law, quote unquote, comes from. And among those treaties and conventions, first thing that we look to, as you mentioned, is the Outer Space Treaty of 1967, or the OST for short. And the OST is the so-called Magna Carta of space law. It is the original fundamental document that we return to over and over. It was first signed by the US with the Soviet Union and the UK as well. And it was signed in the context of the Cold War, as you know, since 1967. So it's not surprising that it's written with certain prevailing issues of that era foremost in the mind. The initial signatories wanted nuclear detente. They wanted to prevent space from becoming the next quote unquote high ground in conflicts. And they wanted to preserve peace in space more than anything. And so at least for those objectives, I think the OST has been largely successful in several decades since it's been signed. And that's reflected by, I believe, the 114 current state parties to the OST, including the original signatories, now Russia, the US and the UK, which are still legally bound by the OST. So great, it's a success story. And the only problem really is that the OST can be very vague at times and it's very short. In fact, it's just a couple pages long. You could read it later today during the coffee break if you wanted. And that would be by and large what you need to know for space law. So unfortunately, with that very short length, it's very imprecise on certain points, but it does offer some precise articles. Unquestionably, placing nuclear weapons, quote unquote, in orbit around the Earth or installing them on celestial bodies is forbidden under Article 4 of the OST. In addition, the article before that, Article 3 of the OST, mandates the conduct of outer space activities, quote, in accordance with international law, including the Charter of the UN. So all of our earthbound international laws are effectively transferred to any conduct that happens in outer space, the same as if it was happening on Earth. And so, as you probably know, Article 2.4 of the UN Charter requires member states to refrain from the threat or use of force against other states. And that's kind of a cornerstone of international law that would bar even the threat of a nuclear weapon, much less its placement in orbit or on a celestial body. So the question is, why are we even having this talk right now? If Article 4 is as clear as it seems, and Russia is still bound by the OST, roughly 57 years after signing the treaty as one of its initial signatories, in fact, why are we talking about this? In many ways, from a legal perspective, it is a no-brainer, right? This is not one of those it depends situations. It's pretty black and white. And what I'd say is, and Nick, this may feed into your talk a little bit, is I think it's a gambit in part on from Putin's perspective. I think the OST is clear about nukes in space, but the OST also lacks a clear enforcement mechanism if there's a breach. And as lawyers, we always say, a contract is only as good as its enforcement mechanism. It's only as good as the fact that you can take it to a court and get an enforceable judgment against someone. Other than that, it's just fancy language that you can wave around all day long, but it's not gonna do you any good. There's also no verification procedure necessarily under the OST. So if the state parties to the OST think that there's a breach, as there might be already, then they may be scratching their heads. How do we make Russia comply if we think that there's a breach besides asking them to come to the table and just talk with us, please? Compliance is obviously very important. And as we've already heard from David in his opening remarks, low Earth orbit is incredibly congested today. Derrill, you mentioned a nuclear satellite killer in LEO would wreak havoc worldwide, that the effects could be felt for up to a year, if not longer. So the stakes are very high. And Russia's launch and that use of a nuclear weapon in space would flagrantly violate several provisions of the OST and threaten life on Earth as we know it now. So before we get to options, let me make one more note from a legal perspective. Even if Russia wasn't one of the founding states to the OST, it wasn't one of the initial signatories, and even if it abandoned the OST today, there is still a very strong argument that today the provisions of the OST have become binding customary international law. So the kind of that second source of international law that we talked about already, that after 57 years of consistent, widespread state practice without any substantive objections, and paired with that sense of legal obligation, Russia is effectively bound by consistent state practice, even if it never signed the OST or even if it left the OST, so that even non-signatories to this Magna Carta of space law and former signatories of the OST would still be bound by those core principles of the OST today. So it's worth noting that. So I'll kind of pivot a little bit from that background, just kind of a quick background on space law to what might happen, what we can do at this point, what the value of international law is without any sort of hard enforcement mechanism or voluntary adherence. Because as you all probably know, international law is largely consent-based. That's what I teach my cadets here at the Air Force Academy on day one, is that states have to agree to be bound by their words, through their words, or by their deeds, or the overriding custom of states. Otherwise, they have sovereignty and jurisdiction and can choose to do what they want, in essence. And if states don't comply with those obligations, then it's on other states. They have to pressure them through politics and diplomacy, or economic sanctions to fall in line effectively and obey those agreements that they've signed. So because the OST regrettably lacks an enforcement clause, those 113 other current state parties to the OST have to appeal to that notion of promises must be kept, and then also just police themselves. So as I see it, Russia has a few options. First, it can continue to comply with its OST obligations, meaning that hopefully, ideally, the reports of a nuclear weapon are unfounded, or that Russia is sort of in the early stages of development and things will be called off. And if that's true, then Russia's weapon plans are probably designed as a bluff. They're probably just another tactic from Putin to scare, intimidate, and coerce adversaries, and that effectively the space weapon is a fake, but it's nevertheless a deterrent threat. It's basically a panic button that Moscow can threaten to hit at any given time. It may be small consolation, but I'll note also from a legal perspective, Russia is unlikely to deploy a nuclear weapon because doing so would just, under space law, would expose it to crippling liability for damage to other states, not to mention potential declarations of war and everything that comes afterward. But one of the treaties that I won't really go into in depth here, but kind of followed on the heels of the OST, was the Liability Convention of 1972. You had three other statutes, conventions that followed after the OST to kind of clean up and clarify some of the more generalized terms in the OST, and that Liability Convention is one of the key ones that came just 5 years later. Under that Liability Convention, Article 3, effectively it imposes kind of two liability regimes, and the one that's not on the surface of Earth, so imagine in orbits or beyond, if there is any sort of damage there, it's a fault-based liability regime. So imposing that on Russia for an intentional detonation of a nuclear weapon would obviously be pretty easy to prove, as long as we can show causation and where the detonation began, things of that nature. So under the Liability Convention, but also under Article 7 of the OST, that imposes international liability on launching states for future liability. So there's a few legal provisions that would effectively say, even if Russia did go down this route, the fallout, the liability, the repayments would just be crippling. They would never dig themselves into that hole. So based on that, it kind of also leans in the direction of, I don't think even if Russia had this capability necessarily that they would go through with it unless they fully knew the extent of the ramifications that would follow. That was first. Second, Russia could blatantly violate its OST obligations. It could pay a heavy price with sanctions, with condemnations, on top of everything else, along with its war against Ukraine. Without an enforcement mechanism, Russia might march forward with weapon plans, even if they constitute a breach of treaty obligations. So in that case, obviously, the West would further isolate Russia from international affairs as a penalty for this misstep. The cynics among us would just say that sanctions haven't substantially impacted Putin's decision making so far. But nevertheless, I think with each new wave of sanctions, Russia's war machine kind of slows down a little bit, and the oligarchs are given more reason to yield and not support war or rash decisions like this. At the very least, I think the U.S. and its allies, they would have to condemn this legal breach and then set incentives to prevent other states like North Korea, example, from potentially taking a dangerous page from Russia's book. The last major option I'll point out for Russia is it could withdraw from the OST. withdraw altogether with 1 year's notice under Article 16 of the OST. This would be unprecedented. We've seen withdrawals from other more minor agreements like the Moon Agreement, which hasn't really ever had much momentum in terms of signatories or following. But the OST is the standard bearer. It's the agreement with more than 100 state parties. So pulling out, oh, sorry.
Nope. I think that's some noise from outside.
Okay, gotcha. So it would be unprecedented, I think, if Russia were to withdraw from the OST. Another option is it could unlawfully abandon the treaty without the proper notice that it needs to give under the treaty. I think that, or even just giving notice, would be political missteps and a sharp departure from decades of reliable peace and security in the space domain that Russia would regret. And so aside from being a terrible legal decision, I think that withdrawal would send the wrong signal to the rest of the world that these vital multilateral treaties or international law more generally are worth keeping, that they're worth participating in and supporting. So again, that would be a dangerous precedent, I think, for space law and international law more generally. But again, even if that were the case, customary international law is always kind of this fallback, and there's that strong argument that nevertheless, even if Russia did pull out of the OST, its actions may later nevertheless be bound by those principles of the OST, Liability Convention, and other space treaties that have been signed in the Cold War era. So I'll leave my comments at that for now. Absolutely happy, like the other panels, to take questions at the end. But I'll stop there, and thank you, everyone.
Great. That was very useful, Matt. Thank you. And finally, Nick Mazdev, what's point in thinking?
Yeah, sure. I'll go ahead and do a couple of points here. First, let me just make a point, and it's something we have to stress a lot now when we talk about Russia, particularly given the climate in Washington, and that is to invoke General McMaster's principle of strategic empathy. You have to understand what your opponents are doing. It's not whether you like what they're doing. It's not whether or not you think it's what they ought to be doing. You have to start with, well, what do they think? Rather than critiquing it. And unfortunately, in Washington now, especially over the last year, McMaster's advice on that is becoming politically fraught, as we're seeing. And this is really having an impact on the Russia expert community because of that. So I wanted to preface my remarks with that observation. This is what my assessment of what the Russians think, whether or not you agree with it, think it's what they ought to think, like the way that they think. Those are separate issues. But you can't have a good response unless you first start with, well, what do they think? And given that, the first point is two general points and then two more specific to this topic. The Russian strategic establishment has a very starkly realist view of the world. There are two conditions for a state. You are either imposing outward or you're being imposed upon. And international relations is finding that balance point where you've pushed out as far as you can reasonably, but you're reasonably sure that others can't impinge on you. And so you're trying to find that state of affairs. There's no belief, there's no trust that there's a benevolent international community that looks out for your interests. It is a realist world. Power matters. Your power position matters. When you become weaker, others will take advantage of your weakness. When you're stronger, you have the ability to set the agenda in ways that benefit you. And that has been a consistent Russian grand strategic approach really over the last several centuries. It's continued from Tsarist to the Imperial to the Soviet to the post-Soviet period. Second thing that is related to that, and specifically over the last 10 years, when Putin and his belief felt that partnership with the West, first with the United States after 9/11, then sort of reaching out to the European core, particularly France and Germany, that this was not going to achieve Russian strategic objectives. Over the last 10 years, it has really emphasized the importance that Russia has to be in a position to resist Western pressure, but that Russia could not adopt the Soviet strategy. That it could not try to compete in all areas across the entire spectrum of capabilities. And that therefore, Putin directed, how can Russia do things asymmetrically? How can it hold important Western equities at risk without having to spend itself into oblivion. Some of that, of course, was to encourage things like energy dependencies, resource dependencies, using sharp power tools to influence Western societies. Space was one of the areas Putin has identified, but as Dave pointed out, right, Russia was not going to compete in the commercial side, but it's how could it hold potentially the Western advantage in space at risk as a way to bring pressure. And so this Russian emphasis on looking for asymmetric ways to resist Western pressure. So the two sort of general comments on Russian strategy across the board. Two now that deal much more specifically with nuclear questions. The third is that the Russian view is, and they actually have a grudging admiration for the ability of the United States over the last 20 years to redefine the Cold War architecture of arms control, particularly in the Bush and the Obama and Trump administrations. From Putin's perspective, the United, again, this gets back to questions about international law, that the Russians don't believe that there is sort of an impartial body of international law that exists separate from states. They look at the United States, they see the United States getting out of treaties, redefining obligations, particularly Putin's experience with trying to convince George W. Bush to stay in the ABM treaty. And failing from his perspective, but then in a sense saying, right, you can leave treaties, we can leave treaties. You can redefine obligations. Well, we will claim for ourselves the right to redefine obligations. So with this, right, the Russians don't talk about this as a nuclear weapon that they're going to orbit. They're going to talk about a nuclear generator or nuclear-powered device, even if it relies on an explosion to generate, right? Then they'll say, well, it's a generator then, right? It's not a, but the point is that the Russians will approach this in the context of saying, look, great powers can redefine laws to what they mean. And again, do you have the power to make it stick? Can you make that redefinition stick? One of the things that is important, right, is that this is not occurring in isolation. It's occurring in the context where the West and Russia are decoupling in many areas. And so it does mean that some of the influence that the West might have otherwise is eroding. What do you mean to continue to sanction, right? At some point, we're certainly running out of people to sanction in the Russian government. The Russians are running out of Americans to sanction in some ways in their counter-sanctions list. But the sense is, all right, if we redefine it and make it stick, what are you prepared to do? And so if this was the only issue on the agenda, then some of these things about, well, sanctions and diplomatic concerns might be raised. We, of course, have been talking to the Indians and the Chinese, but the Russians also talk to the Indians and Chinese and say, tell the Americans, don't do things that put us in a corner, right? That you don't want us to use these kind of capabilities. Fine, we understand. So tell Washington and then tell Brussels, back off in these other areas. And so that there's a two-way use of the China-India dialogue in this. And so it's not just a question of, as we saw Secretary Blinken going to China a few weeks ago, carrying certain messages to the Chinese leadership about Russia. And then, of course, the Xi Putin summit of this past week, which also saw in a reverse direction, that is China and Russia signaling against the United States. So we need to put that in context. Finally, and then the fourth, and since it's 1 o'clock, I'll end on this so we can have our discussion. The war in Ukraine, how it is being fought, the importance of space systems to how that conflict has been carried out. Russian media coverage of the fighting in Ukraine over the last 7 to 8 months has changed. It is basically, the Russian coverage is, this is the West fighting us in Ukraine. These are Western operators of systems, so the Russians persistently have claims that there are already Western forces on the ground in some capacity, operating missile systems, engaged in ISR, controlling targeting. This is part of it, so that the Russian narrative has changed and even now is attempting to say, look, poor Ukrainians, right? Ukrainians are dying, but really they are dying because the West has come in and is utilizing them against Russia. This is part of Russia's own propaganda in Ukraine, which has also changed in the last couple of months. Completely separate topic from what we're looking at here. But this notion that the West is able to do things against Russia in the context of Ukraine, which depend upon ISR capabilities, and therefore the timing of these leaks of, hey, we could destroy satellites, we might be able to, is not accidental. The other thing where this is linked, of course, is the question of dual use systems and their use within targets within Russia proper. And so everything from the transfer of ballistic missiles to aircraft that are nuclear capable. And so this past week, Deputy Foreign Minister Sergei Ryabkov, strongest statement to date, essentially saying, look, all these Cold War arrangements for arms control, they're all basically in abeyance now. And we will respond in a situational capacity based on what we think of as a threat. We see aircraft, we see missiles coming in at targets. We will make, you know, we will draw our own conclusions as to what that means. And so then that also provides a context for this, really, as do the Russians have the capability? I think they certainly do. Have they deployed it? Probably not. But this is part of a signaling effort to say, as the conflict in Ukraine continues, as the prospects for this conflict are ending on terms that are reasonably favored to Ukraine, given the current level of Western aid, are dissipating, and there's talk about the West having to do more involvement, more weapon systems. This is part of a Russian signaling that Russia is going to retain the options to also escalate. And it's for us to determine how much of that is bluff, how much of it is real, but it occurs within that context of essentially signaling that Putin is signaling, look, we're in this for the long haul. We think we're in a long-term conflict now with the West, with the United States, for what's going to happen in Europe. And we are signaling that we still have capacity. And so this, remember, Putin was, a reasonably young man when the Cold War ended. There is a thinking in the current circle in Russia that the Soviet Union ended the Cold War before it really got bad, that there was a lot the Soviet Union could have done in those last years that it chose not to do. And look what happened, right? So this Russian narrative of we were betrayed, NATO expands, we all know the storyline. But this is also a signaling of don't expect, if you think Russia's going to go down this time, it's not going to go down quietly like 1989 or 91, and essentially warning the United States, are you prepared for this? And also to the Chinese, if you don't want this to happen, you might also want to use whatever influence you have on the world scene to essentially bring the, tell the U.S. to maybe step it back a bit. And so again, this is part and parcel of that, and all of these Cold War era tests, reminding you of, hey, you saw what could happen, and we're putting that back out onto the table in the 2020s. So,
yeah, that was great. Thank you. Questions? Julia, if any, I don't see anything in the chat, but if anybody has anything, let us know. But other questions? Yeah, please.
Question specifically for Professor Bostev, but maybe the panel. So Russia has announced, and Putin has given speeches about these five super weapons you may be familiar with. And it struck me that three of those five weapons involve nuclear technology to some extent, one of which is an air-breathing nuclear reactor masquerading as a cruise missile.
Yeah.
To me, it seems to some extent that Russia may be taking, they sense that they have a comparative advantage in nuclear technology relative to some of their adversaries, and they're taking a sort of al dente pasta approach to this, of throwing stuff to the wall. Yeah. And seeing what sticks with their nuclear technology. When I look at this, the prospect of a nuclear weapon in space, to me, I see a further extension of that, sort of that the same thinking that went into we're going to use an air-breathing nuclear reactor as a cruise missile is kind of what I see here, too. To what extent do you think that's true, or would you criticize that?
I think it's a critical point, right? And it really gets at this question of Putin and the Russian establishment saying to the U.S., and we're drawing the U.S. public, right? You will not be exempt from the consequences, right? So you might have seen the Prime Minister of Estonia came out and said, hey, our goal should be the breakup of Russia into smaller states. This is a Russia saying, you want to try that? we can, you know, maybe you could succeed, but we will take a high price, and we will use this fear and the desire not to have, you know, nuclear radiate, whether it's the, you know, the cruise missile, whether it's things in orbit. You want to take the world, you want to take us down. Well, this is almost like a Samson approach, right? And using nuclear, where Russia does have that advantage, and using that as a tool of deterrence. So there's a little bit of madman theory in that, but it's also somewhat of that Samson approach of this will not be cost-free. You don't get to sort of sit back safe in the United States and meddle from 5,000 miles away. We want to remind you that we can, you know, reach out and touch you. And that's, again, why this debate in Washington, just to bring that in, has become, I wouldn't say necessarily toxic, but you do have this, right? There's a party that essentially says, you know, this is, you know, U.S. is self-deterring itself. We could be doing so much more against Russia, but we lack the will, right? This is Putin playing in that to say, okay, you want the will to it? Do you want to risk, you know, nuclear contamination in a variety? Or do you want to lose all of your satellites and all, you know, we're going down, we'll take you down with us. And that impact, again, of that, you know, the current generation of sort of the key Russian leaders, they're all younger men from 89 to 91. And what happened in the 90s was not what they expected would happen. And so there was a bit of that, never again, this time, you know, we're not going to go quietly the way, or, and right, and the reason why Gorbachev is now reviled universally, at least within Russian elite circles, is a traitor. He was the guy. He could have done more, and he didn't. And that's why there's no statues of Gorbachev anywhere to be found inside Russia.
He made Pizza Hut headquarters here in the U.S. I'll just quickly note that there is sort of this strange everything old is new again, where yeah. We've got Project Pluto. If any of you aren't familiar, an unshielded nuclear reactor cruise missile going Mach 3 with a range of like 150,000 miles. In the U.S. version, we imagine this with 1960 guidance technology, which would have been kind of exciting. Today, it might actually go where you want it to go. But we are kind of, you know, nukes in space. You know, there is sort of resurrecting some of these early, you know, kind of late early Cold War ideas, where in the real, you know, in kind of the first Cold War history, the Cuban Missile Crisis and a few other things kind of had to step back from that brink and go, you know what, maybe we should try and make this a more managed and controlled competition. I hope we don't have to have another one of those, but, you know, it's the dilemma that we faced back then that, you know, in this, you know, where both sides, you know, wanted to really push to the brink, and we, the 60s switched to let's have a managed kind of managed competition. And yeah, I think Nick's exactly right. That's how I would see this too, that Putin is kind of going back to the more exciting early Cold War model of you know, any threat you can give us, we can out-threaten it. And that's worrying. You also have a question.
I'm going to use a lot of terms incorrectly, just a heads up, but I think that this this question kind of spans the expertise of all of you. If you want it to be technical, like space has a line at which it starts, not in any real capacity, obviously, but if you wanted to conduct an atmospheric detonation of a nuclear weapon below that line, which I believe is somewhere around 100 kilometers or like 62-ish miles, would it have, could it have potential exo-atmospheric effects while also in some kind of way not going outside of the space treaty and everything else? So I think there's room to at least argue the fact that you could have effects in the space domain while operating within the air domain, and that...
Let me quickly take... I've actually seen some report there, some you know, in some Chinese military or technical journal, there's been a report of some Chinese military scientists proposing something like that, and specifically arguing if it's at just the right altitude, you'd get the initial EMP, but you wouldn't create the radiation belts. Yeah. And I have to totally defer to Derrill on that. meaning you could detonate it when the particular satellites you want to take out are overhead, but you wouldn't create the long lasting. That's like a journal article or two. So, and thank God they haven't tested. They also were imagining a yield in the tens of megatons, which is, impressive. Legally, and I think, any country that's a member of the Limited Test Ban Treaty would still be, and Russia is. China's not, actually. China had never, has never signed on to the Limited Test Ban Treaty. So they have chosen to no longer do new above ground. Nobody's done any nuclear testing since the 90s. China chose to go underground, but they didn't actually sign the treaty that requires it. I don't know, Matthew, anything to add on that kind of
here? And there's been a lot of ink spilled about where space begins. I think the U.S. has been very, very reticent to take an official stance on where that begins. I know it. Many countries, and like you say, also under the Test Ban Treaty, but many countries, including the UN organization, has basically said something like 100 kilometers. I know that for the U.S. As well. I think you're on your astronaut wings, I guess, or something above 60 miles, 100 kilometers. So that would be something like the unofficial line, even though, again, there's been a lot of debate about that and not much consensus.
Yeah, anything? If I recall correctly, you're in space when to go fast enough to have an airflow sustain you against gravity, you're in orbit. You're already beyond escape velocity or whatever. Not escape velocity, but you'd have to be in orbit.
Right.
So, yeah.
More questions?
Put yourself in orbit.
yeah, please.
Hey, Derrill. A bit of a technical question, but I'm just curious. You talked earlier about our government perhaps encouraging satellite companies to harden their satellites a bit to do this. Is that a technologically challenging thing? I mean, do they make like a Faraday cage for their satellites, or is it an easy thing? It just costs money, or is it a really hard thing?
It's not hard. It's just expensive, and it adds weight. So it's expensive. And why not just build a like Elon Musk does, thousands of cheap disposable ones if you can replace them quickly, but it will be months before you can do that.
Dr. Keller, maybe can you talk more about China's role in this, because it seems to me that if it also hurts them, they have way more leverage as Putin becomes more of a madman or withdraws from the Western world. Thanks.
Think you want to take that?
Yeah, I mean, if you look at the dynamics of the recent summit and what's been happening, I mean, the Chinese view is that they don't think Putin, I mean, there's certainly nothing in the Chinese sources that says that they have any question about Putin's mental stability or anything of that sort. They think that he has reasonable demands, that they accept the Russian interpretation, that the West lied to Russia after the 1990s. And of course, that has implications for China when the U.S. sort of says, you know, what would be a settlement in Korea or elsewhere. So in that sense, they don't really, you know, there's not a sense of, well, this guy's kind of like, you know, in the way that they do sometimes will hold Kim or the Iranians a bit at arm's length. That said, of course, they're well aware that they're not going to go to the mat to protect the Russians from, and they're aware that the Russians could take steps that would really damage Chinese interests. So again, that point that China will say to the Russians, as China and India both did in the late months of 2022 about not even tactical nuclear weapons use, hey, don't cross this threshold, don't break the taboo, it would be really bad. But conversely, the Chinese are then going to turn around to the United States and say, maybe you should throttle back, you know, rethink some of the sanctions, rethink some of, or at least come out and maybe, you know, repudiate some of the statements by European partners about what a post-Ukraine war order for Russia would look like, right? And hey, if you do these things, we can then reassure the Russians and get them not to do it. So it's going to depend as much on what the U.S.-China dialogue is like in that. And, of course, China will then seek to maximize it. In a way, I mean, the Chinese, having learned Nixon and Kissinger's lesson, are applying it now, right? That they are closer to Moscow and Washington than Moscow and Washington are to each other. And they're going to maximize that for their benefit. So,
well, I think we are going to have to call it there. So I know people have other electives and other meetings to get to. Thank you very much for coming. And please join. I feel slightly weird since I'm one of the panelists, but please join me. Thank you, Matt.
Thanks, Matt.
Thank you.